most women aren't as lucky as I have been. I never had a rivalry or a hatred with June, my mother-in-law. She welcomed me with open arms and loved me unconditionally as only June could. When we got to the house on Wednesday, April 19th, 2017, the front garden seemed too bright and beautiful and colorful. The birds were happily singing, and I remember thinking that wasn't fair, that it should be quiet and gloomy. But it would be unfair to take away everything that she loved. There is a meme online that makes me think of June. It says, "When I get old, I don't want them to think, 'Oh, what a sweet old lady.' I want them to think, 'Oh crap, what is she up to now?' I want to be that little old lady one day. And I think I have a pretty good role model to look up to." Hello, my lovely friends, and thank you for joining me today. Today's video is a little bit different than the usual video, and it might be too difficult for you to watch. If it is, that's okay. I get it. You can back away now and find any of my other more happy, relaxing videos. My intent with this video is still to have it be relaxing and hopefully helpful for any of you who are grieving any kind of a loss. This candle is a very special candle. As you can see, it's just a basic candle, and I couldn't find a holder for it today. But this candle, I'll explain a little more in detail later. But it is a memorial candle for my mother-in-law, June. And for safety reasons, I'm gonna go ahead and blow it out now. I think she had other plans. Alright. Tomorrow will be the first anniversary of my mother-in-law's death. Her name is June. And I wanted to spend some of this very difficult, but very special time with you, my new family. June was an incredibly inspiring woman, and I wish that I had realized that to its full extent while she was alive. I did realize it, but not 100%. As a young woman, she decided to pursue nursing. And when she was finished school, she had two options. She could go into regular hospital nursing, or she could take more of an adventure and join the Canadian Armed Forces. Being an adventurer, she chose the latter. She was based in Nova Scotia, where she met her first husband and had her two children, my wife and my brother-in-law. Later in life, when her kids were growing up, she did work in our local hospitals, and then later on, she chose to work at an independent clinic. When she was old enough, she retired, or I should say, retired, but continued to work, until she had to formally retire to battle stage 4 lung cancer. She was not a smoker. But I don't want to depress you with all that. She was an amazing woman. She wasn't a cancer victim. She was an amazing woman. She was an artist. She loved to sew. And she made the most intricate quilts. I'm going to insert a clip now to show you one of the most amazing things that I think she ever made and gifted to my wife many Christmases ago. It's this gorgeous paneled fairy quilt. And I will pan over the whole thing, and then one by one by one, I'll go through the fairies so that you can see them up close in detail. As you might be able to tell, she was incredibly talented. This hobby took her on many sewing retreats and eventually earned her many prizes. She was so excited to be entered into local competitions with her quilt guild and art shows. She also has the most beautiful garden, and I do say has because it is still alive. It's strange to see the difference between this year and last year, because as you heard in my eulogy at the beginning of this video, the day that she died at home, and when we got the news, we rushed there. We live within the same city. We rushed there. And I remember how bright the garden was. All the early spring flowers like tulips and all these yellows and oranges and even some bright red. And the birds were so happily singing everywhere. I know that the initial shock can certainly increase the way that things feel, but I think I exaggerated the beauty of it too much in my own head. This year, while I'm filming this on the Sunday before her anniversary, we are in the middle of an ice and snowstorm. So there's no flowers, there's no beauty. The birds have quieted for the weekend. They were starting to sing all of their beautiful springtime songs. But then Mother Nature said, "No, I'm gonna have one last go." So, I look forward to seeing her garden in bloom again. It is still alive, and I hope that it will be for many, many years to come. But now, I wanted to talk to you more generally about grief. I want this whole video to be about my mother-in-law. I love her. She was a wonderful woman. But you don't need to listen to an entire video about a dead woman. What I wanted to talk to you more generally about was grief. There are so many great quotes about grief, but I think one of the best ones I've heard is this: "Grief, I have learned, is really just love. It's all the love you want to give, but can't. All of that unspent love gathers up in the corner of your eyes, and the lump in your throat, and in the hollow part of your chest. Grief is just love with no place to go. And that is from Life as a Mortician's Wife. Last fall, shortly before I began this channel, I was able to attend a local grief recovery group. This wasn't just a coffee and chat kind of group. It's a program designed to help people heal their grief from any kind of loss. The program is based around this book called The Grief Recovery Handbook, The Action Program for Moving Beyond Death, Divorce, and Other Losses, Including Health, Career, and Faith. And it's by John W. James and Russell Friedman, founders of the Grief Recovery Institute, and authors of When Children Grieve. Just trying to let you see it without too much of the lens flare. The ring light flare, I should say. So I just wanted to read you a short portion of the opening to this book. Here is an outline of our lives, the Institute, and the evolution of the Grief Recovery Handbook. John was thrust painfully into this arena by the death of a child in 1977. After discovering a successful process for completing his grief, he continued his career in the solar energy design business. Acquaintances who had heard of his loss and recovery experience brought their friends who were dealing with loss. Soon, John was spending as much time with grievers as he was with contractors, and he was finding his work with the former more rewarding. After a while, he realized that grief recovery was what he was meant to do. As a direct result of John's awareness, the Grief Recovery Institute was established. Russell's introduction to grief recovery came not as the result of a death, but in response to a second divorce coupled with bankruptcy. He never would have equated his circumstances with the word grief had he not been dragged to a lecture on the grief recovery presented by John. At that lecture, Russell realized that there might be a solution for his overwhelmingly painful feelings. The following day, he showed up at the Grief Recovery Institute as a volunteer. 21 years later, he is still there. I know that this might sound a little strange, but much of what we go through is a result of that relationship ending, but not being emotionally healed. When a relationship ends, there may be things unsaid or emotional wounds from many years ago that are unhealed. If we don't find a way to heal it, we can't fully move forward in life. This program guides you through a process to heal your feelings and any wounds you have. It's not about saying goodbye to your loved one if they are deceased. It's about healing yourself and your relationship. It's about completing anything that is still unsaid or unresolved between the two of you. Most of us are not prepared to deal with someone who is upset, let alone someone who is truly grieving. And I want to read another portion of the book to you as an example of this. So this reading comes from page 45 of the book, under the section, They Don't Hear Us. Let's not limit the discussion to the comments heard following a death or a divorce. The following situation, which has nothing to do with death or divorce, illustrates how incorrectly others often respond to our normal feelings. One of our friends was having a party. Her teenage daughter, Mary, had invited three of her best friends to the event. As the party was starting, the phone rang several times. The three best friends each called to say that they had made other plans. Mary was very upset. She went to her mom and told her what had happened. Mom said, "Don't feel bad. There are a lot of nice people here to enjoy. Do you remember that when John's dog died and when his grandpa died, the first response was always, 'Don't feel bad'? Here we go again. Don't feel the way you feel, because sad, painful, or negative feelings are no good. You must find a more acceptable feeling, something positive." Fortunately, a close friend of the family was standing nearby. Mary decided to take another chance at getting someone to hear what she was saying. She told the friend what had happened. He listened, and then he responded, "Ouch, you must be so disappointed." "Yes," she sobbed. He hugged her. She thanked him for listening. She went and cleaned up her face, and then enjoyed the party after her feelings were heard and acknowledged. Grieving people want and need to be heard, not fixed. In this true story, the family friend did not repair anything. He merely heard the emotions being communicated. That was all Mary needed. She could then make the intellectual decision to enjoy the balance of the evening, even though it was not going to be exactly as she had envisioned it. To a certain degree, effective grief recovery is about being heard. This book actually lays out a lot of the not helpful things that we say to grieving people or even upset people, just like that example. This program really opened up my own eyes to a lot of my own flaws. All of the things that I was taught. I was even guilty of making these same kind of comments. The kind of unhelpful comments to a grieving person, including myself, that at least she didn't suffer long. At least it wasn't a long battle with cancer. Just to explain just a little bit more about my mother and mom. Well, she did battle cancer for over 2 years. In the end, what took her was something related to her heart. She had just started a new treatment the day before, but what actually took her life was a heart-related incident. And so at the time, the things we kept telling ourselves was, at least she didn't suffer. At least she wasn't in hospice. At least it wasn't a long, slow death, because just a few weeks before she died, she had enough energy to go on another sewing weekend retreat. So I think that gives you a little glimpse that she still had a fairly decent quality of life, even as she was battling cancer. And while it is true that she didn't suffer the way we thought she would, it wasn't truly helpful to us in our time of grief. But it's the things we've been conditioned to say because we think that it makes someone feel better. Well, the things we say to a grieving person, whether it's over death, divorce, a breakup, the loss of a job, well, the things we may say to them might be factually true, and intellectually true, do not help one's emotional state, and in fact, they may further upset the griever or even infuriate them. Attending this program really helped me to complete things that were unsaid with my mother-in-law. The few instances where I was upset with her for many years but didn't say anything. It also helped me to really address all of the wonderful things and to remember her properly. To not put her on a pedestal, but not demonize her either, which I don't think was possible for me, but I know it can be for other people. This program not only helped me to move into a better place with my grief instead of staying stuck, it also helped me in many ways to be a better person and to be more present with the people in my life. Losing June to date, this was probably one of the most impactful losses that I've had in my life, whether it's jobs or people or death. Losing my mother-in-law was extremely difficult, and after her death in April of 2017, most of my year, especially the first 6 to 8 months, was a fog. If any of you have been here, especially losing someone like a parent or someone who has that kind of a close role in your life, when they die, you don't know what to do with yourself. And for me, I'll be honest, I would come home from work most days, make some garbage dinner, something really easy, and then my wife and I would just spend our evening upstairs in our bedroom watching television because we didn't have the energy to even be in our own living room. And as you can see, this is still bringing some tears to my eyes. Going through this program doesn't mean that you don't miss your loved one, whether they've died or they're no longer in your life for other circumstances. But what I found was it will help you slowly come back to a reality. It will help you to slowly learn how to live your own life again and to not be stuck in that gray, murky place of grieving. You will still love your loved one. You will still miss them. But you will be able to better remember good times and to smile and laugh while thinking about them. The great thing about this program is that you can do it from your own home, all on your own, or even with a partner or two. The book that I showed you earlier, Grief Recovery Handbook. It's very easy to obtain it. In fact, after we finished the program, I bought 4 used copies on Amazon. They were all less than $10, I believe. So, if you're struggling and you're in a dark place and you don't know how to move forward in life, I would encourage you to check out Amazon. When you can, squeeze out that little bit of money to get a used copy. And like I said, even if you don't have anyone you feel comfortable doing this with, you can certainly do it on your own. There are instructions within the book on how to do this with a partner or alone, though it's pretty similar. It's just a few little changes here and there. It's unfortunate, but especially in North America, we haven't been taught very well how to deal with the grief and the loss of a loved one, or divorce, or even just being estranged from a family member or loved one for any reason. This book addresses that. So, even if you're here and you're upset about a fallout with a loved one, or a divorce, or because you've lost your job, you can take a look at this book and it's going to help you. It's going to help you to learn. It's going to help you process. And I think if you let it, it'll help you grow as a person and have a better quality of life going forward. This is kind of unrelated, but I feel like this program, my own recovery, this video here today, it all ties in for me and my life. About a year before I started my channel, I began to see signs. And if you're not a spiritual person in any way, that's okay. I have friends who are atheists, or even just kind of doubtful and questioning, and that's fine. You can think that I'm talking a bunch of hooey right now. I'm not offended, because that's your belief. But anyways, I started seeing signs, essentially that my life was changing, and that it was time to take the reins. And I think over the last year and a half, I misinterpreted it a few times. But took control. I stumbled. I searched for ways to take control of my life. Questioned some of my relationships. I searched for things that made me happy again. If you follow my channel, or most of my videos, you've probably heard me talk once or twice about how I feel more alive, how 2018 is going to be my year. And when those signs first started appearing, so towards the end of 2016, I was kind of lost as to what they meant exactly. But they pointed me in the general direction of happiness. And eventually, I think the puzzle pieces began to fit together, and I still think that they are to this day. Like I said, this grief program really helped me to understand a lot more than just how to heal my grief from losing my mother-in-law. Along the way of this journey for myself, I also figured out that this channel is a big part of what I want to do, and I want to help you. So, I really hope that this video, along with all of my other videos, help in any way they can. From simple relaxation and sleep, to inspiration, to learning new things, especially when it comes to matters of emotional intellect, and even just matters of the heart. So, I am really grateful that you joined me today. I'm really grateful that you've watched all the way through. This is probably one of my more depressing videos. I hope that it didn't bring you down too much. I am in a good place now. I mean, tomorrow, the 19th, will be difficult, but we are going to take it easy on ourselves and just do what feels right. And I think that's really the way to go about things. Never push yourself further than you can do. Honor your own limits, but also know your own limits so you know what you are capable of. And I hope that you all have a lovely night. And if you have any further questions about the Grief Recovery Handbook or anything about my personal experience, please don't be afraid to ask. If it's too personal, I'll let you know. But if I can help in any way, I will. I want to give you all a great big thank you. You are all so very lovely. Thank you for joining me today. And I hope you have a beautiful day.